Good morning. I have to say, it is great to be back. I have really, really missed you the last 2 weeks. The first week, I was going to say I was on holiday, but anyway, I wasn't here. And then last week, I was at Coltness and Boncle, where I conducted my first baptism in Boncle. And wee Caleb was an absolute gem. He was just teeny. And when we went out the back of the church to come back round, the front door was open and I was tempted to run away with him. Was that funny, Emma? Yeah. So, yeah, I was tempted to run away with him. A few intimations this morning. Caffey Church is on Wednesday, and this week you need a ticket because we are having a Mad Hatter's tea party. So you need to come with a hat, look at your best hat. And gentlemen, you are not to be excluded, so look at your best bonnet. Or depending on the result tonight, you could wear your See You Jimmy hat. Although I doubt that's going to happen. But anyway, we live in hope, hence the reason I'm sporting my tartan this morning. So if anybody would like a ticket for Caffey Church at 11 o'clock on Wednesday, if you please see Kate to Bagsy your ticket. Next weekend is really special for everybody here at Cambus Nathan North. It kicks off our 175th anniversary celebrations. We have an open day on Saturday from 10 o'clock to 4 o'clock. If anyone can donate baking, we're still looking for donations. Again, if you could speak to Kate, Kate's got a list of who's bringing what, so we don't end up with loads of the one thing, although we'll probably end up eating it anyway. So if you speak to Kate, are we still looking for door duty volunteers, Anna? Are we covered? We're still looking. If anyone can help with door duty next week, it probably would be better if it was folk out with elders, because the session will meet before the service next week, because the moderator is here, so we will... probably, if people could help with the door, please speak to Anne. Those who have volunteered for the Holiday Club, honestly, I have been working behind the scenes doing things. So a quick meeting after the service today, I just want to run past some of the crafts and things like that that I have chosen. So if just a wee quick meeting after that. But I do commend next weekend to you. We are being joined by the cluster churches. So there'll be folks from Allenton and Shots, and Coltness Memorial and Boncle have closed the churches next Sunday. So they will be worshipping here with us. Everybody should have received an invitation through the post. There's six. I've got about 30 left. Did you get one, Maud? I'm glad it got to you. Yep, so we've got these cards. If anybody wants to take some to pass on to folks who have maybe got a connection with the church but aren't in the congregational role, then if you speak to me, I think I've only got about 30 left, but they've been distributed to everyone in the congregational role, and every child in the school got one too. The Lord Provost has accepted an invitation to come, as has the MSP, which is not really our MSP anymore, because when you call a general election, they cease to be MSPs. So Claire Adamson, no, she's the MSP. Yeah. Oh, so, okay. So she's still an MSP. It's only an MP because it's a general election. I didn't know that. Anyway. So, yes, they have accepted the invitations, and there's been invitations went out to other people. So I really do commend that to you next week. If you are able to come along, please do come along, and please speak to, there's going to be lots of people here that you probably don't know, so please take that opportunity to speak to the folks round about. Now, before we start this morning, I'm wondering, could we have the kids up here just now? 2 seconds. So just before we start, I hope we've not got any smoke detectors. Oh, I'm not doing very well with this. I'm going to burn my finger. Just talk among yourselves. Oh. Mags decorated this for me. Oh. We might get... This is just how my days went. Do you know how I tripped up the step? That's how my days, actually how my weeks went, but never mind. Right, you just could sing a wee song to the congregation while I'm doing this. Moira, I'll maybe get you to help me here. Oh, I've just blown them off. Right, I've given up. I'm going home. Let's do the benediction. I hope this is worth it. Nearly there. So, oh, goodness sake. Is that us, Moira? Thank you. So, it's a very special person's 75th birthday today. Who do you think looks 75? And if you say me, you've had it. Well, seeing you're going your holidays on Friday, who do you think looks 75?
My dad.
Your dad? Your dad? Well, it's actually Harry's 75th birthday this morning. He doesn't look a day over 74, does he? So, Harry, happy birthday to you. Can you play yourself happy birthday? And we'll sing. Do you want to go and get that wee bag? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Harry. Happy birthday to you. There we go. Right, you want to give that to Harry? Happy birthday, Harry, and thank you for everything you do. And we'll take this cake through for coffee after, will we? Right, I think we should go in with the service. What do you think? Okay, we'll get you back up, okay, in 2 minutes. All of you. So if you go and sit there, we're going to do experiments this morning. So, okay. Okay. It'd be quite good if the firemen showed up right enough. Big deep breath. Let us begin our worship with our call to worship this morning. In the midst of life's storms, God is there. What have we to fear? In the darkness and terror, God is with us. Of whom shall God shall be afraid? Rise up, people of God, for you are loved unconditionally. Thanks be to God, who cares deeply for us. Let us join together singing our first hymn this morning. Let us build a house where love can live.
Thank you.
Let us come together in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God of all creation, we come to you from our storm-tossed lives to seek your peace. We come to you with our questions and uncertainties, our worries and anxieties. We come to you from our joy and our happiness, each emotion a kaleidoscope of our feeling in life's changing patterns. More than all of that, we come to you because of what you have done for us in the love of Christ, who brought us freedom by his sacrifice on the cross and showed us new life in his resurrection life. We bless you for the love which has no dimension of length, breadth, or height, coming as it does from the perfection of your being. We come to you knowing that sometimes we have received your grace in vain. We have not relied on your word or wisdom. We have not shown any concern or compassion when we should have. We have not loved our neighbor as we love ourselves. We have remained silent when we should have spoken, and spoken when we should have been silent. We seize the moment to ask you from our inconsistent lives for yet another chance of hearing you say to us, your sins are forgiven. May the mark of that forgiveness be your grace in us as we respond with grace and gratitude to your love. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, wellspring of all that is. You are the sea on which we float. You are the wind that fills our sails. You are the storm that protects us. You are the calm that brings us peace. Open our ears to hear your word. Open our eyes to see your beauty. Open our hearts to be warmed by your love. O God, who is greater than the most powerful forces in this world, enable us to be still and know that you are God. Our Lord, who answers out of the whirlwind of every day, breathe in us your Holy Spirit to strengthen, comfort, and guide us in the midst of the storm. Still, small voice, speak to us this hour, that we might become makers of your peace in our homes, in our communities, and in our world. Eternal God, we ask that you accept our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray that from the grace we have received, what we say and what we do will enable those around us to glimpse the life of your Son, who calmed the storm with words which still echo down the centuries. Be still. We pray all this in the name of the one who calmed the raging sea. Amen. Before I start with the all-age message, I meant to say that we had a lovely email from the session clerk at Cambusnethan Old, from Tom Donaldson, just wishing us all the very best for the 175th anniversary. And he just said that to pass on his congratulations from their congregation to ours. So just, yes. Right, this could all go wrong. I haven't even tried it. So, do you want to come up and see if we can cause a storm? I think you should be praying. Where do you see this, Maud? I hope I don't make a mess. Oh, which you see. I did go into the co-op this morning buy a kitchen roll and I went and left it in the car. So, right. I should have opened these first. When you've got nails on, they don't really work very hard. Thank you very much, Lila. Do you know I could drink that? I drink vinegar, don't I, Bill? Oh, I love vinegar. See, sachets of vinegar. Oh, I love.
I used to drink vinegar when I was five, right? But one day, I drank vinegar, right? And
I love vinegar.
There was this like big black stuff.
It was a black.
It was like a big black spot.
A big black spot with drinking vinegar.
Yeah.
Oh, I love vinegar. Then, how are we doing, Lila?
Is there scissors?
I don't think there's scissors.
Because. Oh.
Right. Could you pour all that into the bowl? All of it, I think. Yeah, pour all of it in. Pour all of it in. Okay. So, no? It's like ready, steady, cook. So we've got a bowl filled with baking powder. Okay? Right. So who's next? Right, Robbie. So what I want you to do is pour in the vinegar, but gently, okay? Stand back in case it goes... That's the vinegar.
Stand back.
Okay, let's pour it in. Hurry up. Just pour it in until I tell you to stop. Keep pouring. Oh, what's happening? Keep pouring. Maybe stop.
Maybe stop.
Oh, so we've got this. Right, quickly. Somebody put in a tiny wee bit of oil. A wee bit of oil. No, quickly, hurry up. Just a wee bit. A wee bit more, maybe. Oh, we're still going here. Look. Right. A wee bit more oil. A wee bit more. Pour a wee bit over this side. Right, okay. So, we've poured the oil in. And what's the oil done? What's the oil done? It's calmed it down, hasn't it? Thank goodness for that. So, it was much bigger than that. It was much bigger than that. But we poured the oil in, and the oil calmed it down, didn't it? Because where do you think it would have went to if we hadn't put the oil in? It would have went all over the place, wouldn't it? It would have been like the magic porridge pot. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be fair.
You having a wee dig at that, Emma? Yeah? So, today, our Bible reading is about Jesus being on a boat. And Jesus fell asleep on the boat. And the disciples were in the boat with him, and they hit a storm, a bit like what we caused this morning, okay? So they went to wake Jesus up because they were terrified. And Jesus stood up and said to the ocean, "Be still," and immediately it stopped. And that's kind of a bit like our lives. See, when our lives get like stormy and we just feel that things are getting out of control, just like the oil, when we add Jesus into that, it can help to settle us down because we know we're not doing it on our own. So that's what we're talking about this morning. So when life gets too much and the storms, you can see it just growing and growing and growing, couldn't you? And then we put the oil on it and it calmed it down. So we have to remember when things feel like too much for us. If we pray to Jesus and ask Jesus to be with us. Oh, there we go. It's going right down now. What about we do this? If we ask Jesus, there we go, to be with us through the storms, then it goes calm, doesn't it? Like that. Okay. So I want you to remember that when things feel like they're getting out of control and things are bubbling over, just like we did with the oil this morning, that when we add Jesus to our lives, then things get much calmer and much more settled. Okay. What's that? Is Emma playing it? There's loads more in there. So there is. So there we go. Lila's going to say a wee prayer. You're just going to say it in here, Lila. Let us pray.
Dear God, thank you for being in control. You can calm the weather and waves and bring peace to our troubled hearts. Thank you for taking care of us all. Help us to trust in you every time, everything we do. Thank you for your love, because we love you too. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And now we're going to sing Spirit of God, Unseen as the Wind. Thank you so much for your help. Into my vestry and get the sweetie bucket out and take a sweetie, take it through to the junior church, okay?
Thank you. Today's reading is from Mark 4, verses 35 to 41. On the evening of that same day, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." So they left the crowd. The disciples got into the boat in which Jesus was already sitting, and they took him with them. Other boats were there too. Suddenly a strong wind blew up, and the waves began to spill over into the boat, so that it was about to fill with water. Jesus was in the back of the boat sleeping with his head on a pillow. The disciples woke him up and said, "Jesus, teacher, don't you care that we are about to die?" Jesus stood up and commanded the wind, "Be quiet." And he said to the waves, "Be still." And the wind died down, and there was a great calm. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Why are you frightened? Do you still have no faith?" But they were terribly afraid and began to say to one another, "Who is this man? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Amen, and thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, Bill isn't great at DIY. Even before his accident, it wasn't his forte. He gave the abbreviation DIY a new meaning. Destroy it yourself. This was particularly evident a number of years ago when Bill and I bought our current house. We had a water tank upstairs in the loft which was leaking, and Bill went up to have a look. He discovered a pipe that was leading to nothing and nowhere. So hacksaw in hand, he proceeded to cut said pipe leading to nowhere and nowhere, nothing. Well, the next thing I knew was hearing Bill literally screaming. I immediately run upstairs, and there at the loft hatch was Bill drenched. And I mean drenched. I have to admit that I went into hysterics of laughter. I laughed a lot. That was until I seen cascades of water running down the walls. I ran downstairs to try and turn off the water at the mains. Now, bearing in mind, we'd just got the keys 2 days earlier and we hadn't moved into the house, which was lucky. I couldn't turn the mains tap. Now, my dad was there and he tried as well, but no luck. Next door heard the commotion. So Ian came running out the back, our new next door neighbour, and I told Ian what had happened. So he grabbed a hammer, he was a plasterer, so that was fine. He came in and he loosened the water valve to allow us to turn the water off. My dad told Bill that day that his hands were for nothing more than using a pen or a pencil, as he said, and to leave the DIYs to the professionals. It was a great reminder to me of the power and the danger of water. If you've ever had a flooded wash machine or a burst pipe, you will know the damage that water can do. Or if, like me, on our first cruise last November, travelling through the Bay of Biscay at the height of raging storms, you know what the current can do, and so does your stomach. If you've ever experienced monsoon rains, you will know the power of water. It is a formidable force and can cause deep chaos and damage, as we know too well from the news reports where flooding is a regular occurrence in certain areas. In the reading we've just heard from Mark's Gospel, we know that the disciples of Jesus knew all about the force of water when they were caught up in the storm. Jesus and the disciples were in the boat on Lake Galilee, or the Sea of Galilee. The Lake of Galilee is about 13 miles long and about 8 miles wide. It's also in a valley area, so when the wind whips up, the storms can arrive before you even know it, and it's easy to get caught out. But these were experienced fishermen. They knew the lake really well, and so they wouldn't have gone out for a moment if they thought that there was any danger of a storm being whipped up. The ferocity of this storm comes from nowhere. And the disciples didn't know what to do. There they were, sailing happily across the lake, when a gale whips up without warning, and they are scared for their lives. They think they are about to sink, and in the midst of all their problems, Jesus stays asleep at the back of the boat. He was exhausted. There were so many demands on Jesus to teach, to heal, to show compassion and loving and kindness with every person that he met, hour after hour, minute after minute. So much was demanded of Jesus, it wasn't surprising when he eventually did get some rest that he would fall into a really deep sleep. But this, of course, was lost on the disciples. In their fear and anxiety, they shook Jesus and shouted, "Master, Master, we are about to die." So Jesus gets up and orders the wind, and immediately it dies down. A great calm comes upon the waters. With just a couple of words, "Be still." Jesus, who had not been sufficiently bothered by the storm to be woken up by it in the first place, calmed the storm down with apparent ease. But according to Mark, that was when the real terror of the night began. The only time in these brief verses when the disciples are described as terrified is not when the storm was swamping the boats, but after Jesus rebukes both the wind and the disciples. The terror in their eyes and in their voices comes not when they are shaking Jesus awake to ask if he doesn't care if they live or die, but only when they are asking each other, "Who is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him." We are not told the disciples were filled with wonder. We are not told they are asked this question with trembling joy or anticipation. We are not told that they ask one another this question in the excitement rising in their voices. No, we're told they were terrified. And the discerning reader has to wonder why. After all, the disciples have been with Jesus long enough now to have seen loads of spectacular things, healings, including the casting out of demons. Mark's gospel is nothing if not super dramatic from start to finish. The disciples have been long enough to sense that he possesses phenomenal powers and is, by most any reckoning, no ordinary man. That's true. But they hadn't seen him command the forces of nature in this way. But it wasn't the first time that they had seen his power at work in and through the very words of their master. Yet they are terrified at this display. "Who is this?" they asked. It's not a bad question. When they ask this question, I'm sure they say it with terror in their voices. For whatever reason, it's pretty clear that this incident with the waves and the wind tipped the disciples off that Jesus was not just a skilled healer, but was in fact God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, the one who could command these elements as well. And maybe that's the part that terrified them. It's one thing to think that you've hitched up with a highly charismatic teacher and healer, but it's another to think that you're in the middle of an inner circle of one very gifted human being. If you've ever had the chance to shake the hand of someone of great importance, the Prime Minister, the First Minister, a member of the royal family, Ally McCoist, you know there is a certain electricity that courses through you, at being in the presence of such an extraordinary person. Things for the disciples feel a wee bit different. They are in the presence of not just a gifted person, but no less than God himself. If you have a chance to realize that you've been hanging about with God all along, suddenly you start to wonder about other things. Suddenly you wonder if he can read your mind, know your thoughts, see the envy and the anger and the things you didn't say but wanted to. Suddenly you wonder if you've been sitting up straight enough and behaving well enough all along. If maybe the things you've done and said might have consequences well beyond the present, maybe into eternity. The presence of God, it is what we want, it is what we look for, but isn't it something that the thought of terrifies us? We can only feel safe about it in case we are convinced that the God in whose presence we are in is finally a good and gracious God, a God who loves us despite our foibles and sins, despite the things that he can see going on in the darker places of our hearts and minds at any given moment. Thankfully, another part of the answer to the question, who is this, is also that he is indeed full and gracious and filled with mercy. There's something quite fascinating about the sea in the Bible. The sea is mentioned loads of times. In the book of Job in the Old Testament, God determines the course of the sea. In the book of Revelation in the New Testament, there is a description of heaven, the New Jerusalem, where the sea will be no more. Many other references too. But what is particularly interesting is that when the sea is mentioned in the Bible, more often than not, it is used as a metaphor. In the Bible, the sea is used as a metaphor representing chaos and disorder. So in the book of Revelation, for example, when it says there will be no more sea in heaven, it is a metaphor to say that there will be no chaos in heaven, that everything will be beautifully peaceful and in order. So in this story from Mark's gospel, when Jesus calms the storms and the sea is stilled, it is a symbol for us that God can still the chaos and disorder in our lives. In some versions of the Bible, it says Jesus rebuked the storm, which is an illustration of the divine power of God at work in the world. I'm sure many of you will remember the film Forrest Gump, a great film about a young man with additional support needs who happens to be a really profound and wise person. And Forrest Gump has some great catchphrases. The most famous, of course, is Mama always used to say, life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. And there's a real truth in that, isn't there? Life is so unpredictable. We don't know what surprises lie in store from us from day to day, hour to hour, minute to minute. Good things in life take us by surprise, and we celebrate those moments. But sadly, though, there are negative and difficult times that creep up on us and impact us when we least expect it. There are times in our lives when we feel at the mercy of the storm, when we feel as if our lives are as chaotic as the buffeting ocean. Perhaps a financial crisis, an illness, a bereavement, a breakdown of a relationship. Perhaps you're a worrier like me who worries if I don't have anything to worry about. And we pray, and we pray, and we pray, and we pray. But sometimes it's as if Jesus is asleep. He doesn't hear, no matter how loud we shout. Doesn't it seem sometimes in life as if Jesus is asleep in the back of the boat? What we do know, what our experience is as Christians, is that when life seems tough, or when we see the sufferings of others, it is right and appropriate to be persistent in prayer. We need to keep on calling on Jesus in our most difficult times, because in our persistence, we believe that he does hear us and will rebuke the storms, and the chaos of our lives will be stilled. The disciples were desperate. Their lives were in danger. They thought they would die. Their faith was weak, but in their weakness, they called out to Jesus, and he heard them and rescued them. And so it is with us. In the weakness of our faith, in the chaos of our lives, in the midst of our anxieties and fears, we too can call out to Jesus in confidence that he will hear us and will meet us in the storms of our lives. And when we call out to him, when we cry out to him, he will respond. Be still. Let us join to sing our hymn, Lord of All Hopefulness.
Lord of all.
Let us pray. This morning, God, Scripture reveals that when we need you, you will come. With hands outstretched towards us, you invite us to take hold and be looked after. We present our offerings to you, the gift of money we make in other ways, and our time and talent. May this readiness to serve you and the world be an acknowledgement of our trust in you and our willingness to give illustration of your love to others through our own faithful living. Lord God, show us how to have trust. Lead us to know the full conviction of our faith, that whatever strife or storms we find ourselves in, you will come to us, extend your hand, and invite us to take hold of it. Show us how to believe. Reveal the full breadth of your glory that we might lift the limits on what we are prepared to and are able to envisage as the possibilities of life and creation under the energy of your Holy Spirit. Show us how to live. Teach us through the stories of the Bible and the example of others that we might understand the way of discipleship and apply it in the way we set about living our own lives. Compassionate God, many in our world live with fear, and many find it difficult to do anything than cower away from the world as it is beaten by the pressures, challenges, anxieties, and the worries of the day. We pray today for those drowning in the sorrow of their grief and the emptiness of their loneliness, for those drowning in squalor, poverty, and hunger, for those drowning in the inadequate availability of basic resources, for those drowning in a sea of violence and hatred as victims and as those embroiled in it, and for those drowning in an ocean of despair as they see no way out and no prospect of change in their life circumstance. God, your love for people is no illusion. It is no trick of clever rhetoric. It is no mere opiate created by the church to ease people's pain. Your love is real. It is living and it is present here with us now. Through your church, may this love be known in the world and made available through all who we come across. May people come to believe in the consistency of your love by the words and actions of our own faith. Praying as Jesus asks us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our final hymn this morning, Longing for Light. May God's Spirit surround you, giving you rest in his calm embrace. Let your hearts be warmed and all storms be stilled by the whisper of his voice. Be still. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you and all those whom you love, this day and forevermore.